everybody. Thank you, Dr. Kishore, for your kind introduction. I'm really very happy to be here in my own department after quite a long time. Maybe after 25 years, I'm here in this department. And I'm a proud alumni of BHU and proud alumni of this very department. Let me congratulate all of you that you are now the part of the BHU, part of the legacy of the BHU. You are now the part of the teaching faculty of BHU, and that way you have larger responsibilities. I begin congratulating you for being here. Your presence here is symbolic of your worry about becoming a good teacher. Teaching is not a very easy profession. Teaching is a very, very tough profession. And you cannot really teach well unless you are deeply involved with the subject. Teaching is not really an easy profession. And you are here. This simply explains how much you are worried about becoming a good teacher. The fact that you worry about being a good teacher means that you already are one. I mean, this shows that you are really serious about learning the techniques and learning how to become a good teacher. So that's something really good, and I must congratulate you for having this kind of quality. Okay, good teaching practices. What are the good teaching practices? One thing we really need to understand that teaching is a kind of profession which cannot really be learned. Teaching comes from inside. You cannot become a teacher by merely learning the art of teaching or learning the skills of teaching. That really comes from within. So good teaching is something inbuilt. But good teaching practices can be learned somehow. Good teaching practices in Ayurveda is a very, very difficult kind of thing. I mean, teaching in some other kind of subject is a different thing, and teaching in Ayurveda requires very different kind of skills. We would be discussing about that, how it is really different than teaching in other subjects and what kind of a special skills it requires to become a teacher in Ayurveda. The biggest ironies in Ayurvedic teaching is that we teach and practice differently. This is one very, very famous phrase which is being told by one of my very, very reverend teacher. My own professor has told this, that Ayurvedic teaching irony is we teach differently, we do differently. What we do, we never teach it, and what we teach, we never do it. So there are no relations between teaching and doing in Ayurveda, in practicing Ayurveda, in making teaching of Ayurveda, there are no connections. So this is the irony of Ayurvedic teaching. Moreover, this is also being told that passing the examination in Ayurveda is entirely a different art and a skill. I mean, for what do you require to pass an examination in Ayurveda? It's entirely different than surviving in the field of Ayurveda. What you have learned in colleges possibly may not really be helping you a lot in surviving, in ensuring your own survivals. So this is the kind of contradictions which are there in the field of Ayurveda, and that really requires to be learned. So good teaching practices. What are the good teaching practices? And what should be the quality of a teacher? What it requires to be a good teacher? To begin with, what we can do, we can simply start recalling our own teachers which we feel that they were the good teachers who have taught us. So if you recall or if you remember your favorite teachers during your studies and see the reasons for which they are remembered, you can identify certain specific qualities of those teachers which have made them still being remembered in your mind. You are still recalling them because of certain of the qualities which they are having, they had. So what are these kind of qualities which you, because of those reasons you are recalling your teachers still now? I am able to recall one of my teacher in Ayurveda, Professor C.B. Dubey, when I was doing my graduation there in Lucknow. He is being recalled for his punctuality. I mean, he was supposed to take the class in the morning 8 o'clock. And he was there in the classroom, exactly at 8 o'clock in the morning. Sometime it happened that the students were not there, but the teacher was right there at 8 o'clock in the morning. We are still recalling him for the quality he was possessing. It was the punctuality, what he was having. The other quality could be the simplicity. We are also recalling some of our teachers for their simplicity. I was doing graduation BSc in science at Jhansi sometime. And I was still, I'm still able to recall one of my teacher of zoology. He was a professor of zoology, and he was so simple that by merely seeing him, it was very difficult to identify that he is a professor of zoology or professor of such a senior college. I mean, he is such a senior professor of that college. So he is being recalled because of that simplicity. Connections with the students. There are certain people, there are certain teachers who are really connected with the students. I mean, they really get into the students and they really feel connected. So there are certain teachers whom you might be recalling because of their connectivity or their connectedness with the students. The knowledge, of course, the knowledge is very important. And there are many teachers who are being recalled because of their knowledge, which they are trying to explain or trying to give to their students. Demonstrability is also one very, very critical issue or critical quality which is possessed by many of the teachers. If you are able to explain the things properly and if you are able to demonstrate the things properly, possibly there are possibilities that those subjects are going to be learned by more nicely or more well by the students comparing to merely explaining the things by words or by text. So that is also one quality which is possessed by the teachers. Expressibility and communicability, this is the wonderful quality our own teacher, Professor Ramar Singh Ji, was having from this department only. So he was possessing a wonderful expressibility and wonderful communicability for which he is still remembered. So good teaching is what? Good teaching is 1/3 of the knowledge and 2/3 of how you present it. Good teaching is not all about the knowledge. You might be having a lot of knowledge, but the more important thing is that how do you present it to the students. So 2/3 of the good teaching practice is about how you are going to present it to the students. You can also be remembered for the wrong reasons. There can be a number of reasons for which the teachers are remembered. There can be not a number of wrong reasons. These reasons could be the over-discipline, incomprehensibility of the communication. What you are speaking to your students, it is completely incomprehensible. They are not really able to understand what you are trying to explain. You can be recalled by means of lack of connectedness. You are not connected with your students. I mean, you are not really related with what they are trying to understand or what they are willing to know. Lack of punctuality, this is also one reason. Lack of equality, you have different eyes for the different people. And lack of fairness, this is also one reason why many teachers are being recalled or remembered. Inability to appreciate the student's need, this is also one reason you may be recalled. So there can be right reasons to be remembered and there can be wrong reasons to be remembered. So you need to choose for what reason you may be recalled or you may be remembered by your students. Teacher as a role model. Have you ever been inspired by any of your teacher? I mean, you just have to think of that. Are there any teachers who have really inspired you to become like him? Do you feel like this? Yes, this is the teacher to whom I should also be. I mean, I want to be in my future. I want to be like him. So you need to identify. Have you ever wished to become like him? Wouldn't you like to become the role model of your own students? This is the ideal. I mean, this is something which every teacher should dream for. What inspires me to teach? When I am a teacher, if I look back at me, what is my inspiration? I wasn't born to just teach. I was born to inspire others, to change people, and to never give up, even when faced with challenges that seem impossible. This could be the inspiration of a teacher, and this could be the inspiration to become a teacher. Why did you decide to become a teacher? What is your inspiration? I mean, why you are here? Why you have opted to become a teacher at the Faculty of Ayurveda? So you need to identify what your inspirations are. Your inspirations could be to earn livings. I mean, you are here because you are simply joining it as a profession to earn livings, to earn respect, to earn social positions, to make your life better. Compulsion, since there was nothing else to do because you did PG and now there is no more things. I mean, you do not have anything else to do apart from becoming a teacher. So for that reason, you are a teacher. Because I like sharing and helping, this could be another reason. And Because I want to ignite the young mind's own quest towards knowledge by showing them a glimpse of wisdom already available all around them. This could also be one important reason. I mean, there can be several reasons. There can be several reasons for you to become a teacher. You need to identify what your inspiration is. I mean, why you have opted to become a teacher in Ayurveda. You can be a good teacher only if you truly wish to make the life of others better. I mean, besides this, no other reasons are going to make you a good teacher. The only reason of becoming a good teacher, if you want to make the life of others better, then only you can become a good teacher. So good teaching practices in Ayurveda. Remember that you are a teacher now. I mean, you have opted a profession. Now you are there only, and there are no possibilities of escaping out from here. So you have to bear with these responsibilities. Does not matter what all your aspirations has been. I mean, no matter for what you have opted to become a teacher, but now you are a teacher, so you need to understand that you are a teacher now. Being a teacher is highly demanding, and you need to get ready to comply with such demands. And being a teacher in Ayurveda has some very unique challenges not common to other subjects. This is also something very, very strange, which is very peculiar to Ayurveda. So challenges of Ayurvedic teaching. What are the challenges of Ayurveda teaching? Because you are already here, you might be understanding that what kind of challenges you are facing. The biggest challenge is challenge of demotivation. For a teacher, you are really not really very much motivated to become a teacher or to excel in the field. Demotivation is of self demotivation. Lot of salary related, promotion related, appraisal related issues which make you demotivated. Students' demotivation, to whom you are trying to teach or trying to explain, they are also not very much motivated to learn Ayurveda. So when they are not interested to learn Ayurveda, to whom you are going to talk about and to whom you are going to teach about? So that is also, you have to face with this kind of problem, demotivation of yourself and demotivation of the students also to whom you are going to teach. Challenges of inadequate knowledge resources. This is also one big challenge which is there in Ayurveda. Poor libraries. I mean, you are really fortunate that you are here in BHU now. You are equipped with a wonderful library. It's one of the best libraries in the country. But besides this, those people, those poor teachers who are belonging to different colleges, they do not really have any facility to have update their knowledge. They have poor libraries with minimal physical books, no access to online resources, e-books and journals. There are no possibilities of updating or extending their knowledge. Challenges of getting untrained for the teaching skills. You do not have any opportunity to get trained for the teaching skills. There are certain CMEs, there are certain ROTP programs, orientation programs, but they are also not up to the standard, up to the mark, which are really giving you the real knowledge about how to teach. So no teaching skill development during PG courses, no teacher training program for aspiring teachers. For aspiring teacher, we do not have any program. Challenges for getting the peer views from across the discipline in Ayurveda. We do not have. We do not have what the others are opining about ourselves, about Ayurveda, about our methods of teaching, about our knowledge. So this is also, we do not get any access to such kind of things. Challenges for getting the peer views across the disciplines beyond Ayurveda. This also is not possible in Ayurvedic teaching fraternity. Challenges of self-evaluation appraisal. We do not have any mechanism which evaluates your own teaching skills. We do not have anything like this. We do not appraise ourselves. Challenges of evolving continuously. This is one big problem. There are no mechanism or no methods which are keeping you evolving continuously. So these are the challenges which every Ayurvedic teacher is facing. Current Ayurveda teaching, I mean, we have conducted a very small survey there in our college, at a state Ayurvedic college, and we have inquired from the students that how do they rate the teaching in Ayurveda? How do they perceive teaching in Ayurveda? It was a random survey, and you are going to be surprised by the results which are obtained from this survey. the majority has observed that Ayurvedic teaching is what? It's a monotonous teaching. This is the students' version, what the students are rating about the Ayurvedic teaching. They said that it is a monotonous teaching based on classical text, shloka, and their literal meanings. What the teachers are trying to do, they are reciting a shloka and they are trying to explain its meaning, and that's all. This is the teaching. Based on textual description of modern medicine, the same is being done in the modern medicine also. You take some text from the modern medicine and you try to explain it, and that's all. This is the teaching. Monologue and non-interactive teaching. Many times what teacher does, I mean, you keep on speaking without listening from the students. So it's monologue rather than being a dialogue. No interaction is there. Teaching based on textual repetition without any value addition. You keep on repeating the same kind of thing every time, every year, without any addition of your own knowledge or your own understanding. This is also a problem in Ayurvedic teaching. No real life examples in teaching, especially for those subjects which are not really related with real life. They become very difficult to be understood by the students because they do not find it connected with their own life. So it's very difficult to understand these things. Knowledge not linked with practical applications. This is also one very, very big problem which has been identified by the students. Focus on theory rather than practice, even in the clinical and practical subjects. Lot many subjects there in the clinical side, even in Kaya Chikitsa, if I talk about, lot of theoretical aspects are being taught in the classes which are never being practiced in the clinics. I mean, you never observe these things are in the practice anywhere. So this is also one problem which has been observed. No good explanations of the concepts. You keep on talking about the concepts, but you do not really explain them well. No good explanations of the prescriptions. Even in the clinics, the OPDs, the doctors are writing wonderful prescriptions which are responding, giving the responses to the patient. But these prescriptions are also not explained to the students, so they are not really able to appreciate it, that why or how this prescription has been generated. No good exposure to clinical and laboratory practices. Nobody explains them how to do it. So these are the problems which have been identified by the students of Ayurveda who are taking the studies from the teachers, and they have identified that these are the problems which are related with the, and moreover, the queries are unwelcomed. Many times it happens, if you ask a query, possibly your teacher is not going to like it. So queries are not really welcomed in Ayurvedic teaching. So good teaching practices in Ayurveda, what are the quick tips? I mean, how to become a good teacher in Ayurveda, there are certain quick tips. Have a good acquaintance of the original subject. This is first thing which is really required. Make yourself updated by knowing about the advances. This is also something very, very important. Choose the language where you feel comfortable. This is also one thing which has to be understood very well. You need to speak in the language where you are feeling comfortable and also where your students are feeling comfortable. You need not to choose a language where you are not having a command with, or where your students are not feeling comfortable. So you need to choose the language carefully. Understand the level of your students. This is also something very important. When you are teaching the undergraduate courses, you need to be at that level. When you are teaching the first year student, you need to be at that level. And when you are teaching the postgraduate or research students, you need to be at that level. So you need to understand the level of your students. Understand the need of your students. This is also something very important. You need to understand that what they really require from you. So this is also something which has to be understood. Be sure that the message is delivered appropriately. This is also something very, very important. I mean, when you are continuously speaking among the audience or before the audience, you need to understand that whether this message which you are trying to communicate or give to the audience is reaching appropriately or not. That is also something important to be understood. Allow your students to speak. This is also something important which has to be understood. It should not be the monologue, but it should rather be a sort of interaction or should be a dialogue. Listen carefully if somebody is making any comment in between. So listen carefully and reply patiently. This is also something very, very important which every teacher has to understand. And keep on learning and evolving every day. This is something which is really very, very important for a teacher also, because teaching, once you are entered in the teaching profession, it is not that your learning stopped. You need to evolve continuously so that you can update yourself day by day, every day.